Okay, let me introduce myself. My name is Rohit Mutatkar. I am working as an assistant professor at the Center for Study of Social Exclusion and Inclusive Policies. This is a research center that exists within the institute and which is funded by UGC to work on issues relating to poverty and inequality, especially among certain social groups in the population. So I am going to be here actually for only this one class in this whole foundation course. And the topic, if you see in your outline, is actually given as the balance sheet of human development in the developing world. But I have written it more broadly as poverty and human development. So my basic purpose will be to introduce you and to make you familiar as to what do these terms actually mean. Because even if you look at the whole mandate of the institute, irrespective of what program of study you're coming from, the mandate of the institute is to work on issues of poverty and among the marginalized groups in the population, if you look at it on the website. Okay. So in this next, whatever 1 hour, 1.5 hours we have, I'll try to introduce you to these terms and also how these are to be assessed. How do we actually assess poverty and how do we actually assess human development? So what are the various concepts and measures that are involved? Now let us start with this term poverty. Now I imagine that this is a term which all of you have come across umpteen number of times, and all of us have some idea as to what it really means. Now if this was really a classroom, which unfortunately it is not, I could have asked each one of you as to what do you really mean by poverty, what is your understanding of the term poverty, and I imagine that the kind of answers I would have got would be something like inability to meet basic needs, you know, food, clothing, shelter, or in its most extreme form, some of you might associate it with lack of food, that is starvation. Now that would be a perfectly correct answer, but let me move on to a more difficult question, that is the second question. Let us say as part of your, you know, MA or MSc dissertations, or as part of the internship that you're going to do after the first year with whatever organization you're working with, you're asked to go to a particular village or a particular, you know, slum area, and you're asked by your supervisor or by your agency to come back with a list of the poor households in that village or locality. Okay. So we have some broad understanding of what poverty means, inability to meet basic needs. The second step is you actually go to an area and come up with a list of the poor households in that area. Now, how are you going to do that? You can just spend some time thinking about it. This is a slightly more difficult question because now you have to think of specific criteria on the basis of which you are going to call one household as a poor household and another household as a non-poor household. Okay, or the terms that you often read in the newspaper are below poverty line or above poverty line, that is APL or BPL. So on what basis are you actually going to classify households into BPL or APL? That is a much more difficult exercise. And the moment you try to do this kind of exercise, you are then working with a notion of what is called as a poverty line. Okay, so as I mentioned in the slide here, the poverty line is something that is used to classify the population into the so-called poor and the so-called non-poor. Now, with respect to this definition of a poverty line, okay, if you try to understand poverty using this notion of a poverty line, one can define poverty more broadly as deprivation with respect to a normatively specified minimum living standard. So you have in mind a certain minimum living standard on the basis of which you are going to classify the population into poor and non-poor, and deprivation is then with respect to that normatively specified minimum living standard. So why are we using this term normatively specified? Because however scientific you try to be, however objective you try to be, there is always going to be certain subjectivity involved. Now many of you might have been following the news in the television channels, in newspapers over the last 1 year, even the last few months. There has always been such a lot of controversy about how the poverty line should be defined. In fact, in the Indian context, it is a tragedy that most of the debates in poverty tend to revolve around what should be the poverty line and how the poverty should be measured, rather than trying to understand what are the constraints or difficulties faced by the people to actually come out of poverty and what are the kind of interventions that are required. Okay. So in the Indian context, you know, I don't want to go over all the debates, but there are two specific aspects I want to mention here. One is the estimation of poverty exercise based on the consumption expenditure surveys of the National Sample Survey. You know, all of you have heard about a planning commission. Very soon that is going to be replaced by some other body. And the official estimates of poverty in India are those given by the planning commission. And the database for this is generated from these consumption expenditure surveys of the National Sample Survey. So National Sample Survey, as you would have, you know, read, is an organization that comes within the Central Statistical Organization. Now, this estimation of poverty exercise, in this the poverty line is defined in terms of a expenditure level that is referred to as a monthly per capita expenditure level and based on a calorie norm. Okay, you all must be familiar with this term calorie. So from where is this coming from? You are trying to associate poverty with the most basic need, that is food. But rather than trying to see the quantity of food consumed, there is so much of, you know, variation throughout the country. The dietary patterns are so different. Instead of seeing the quantity of food, these planners try to identify it in terms of the energy intake that food is going to give you. So that is how this whole notion of a calorie norm came up. Now in your next module, that is going to be discussed by Dr. Ramkumar on India's development experience, I think you have a whole lecture devoted to the theme of estimation of poverty in India. So I'm not really going to go into this at all right now. I want to focus on the second issue, that is the identification of the poor based on the below poverty line census. So what is this we are referring to? If you look at operationally, what is actually going on? If you go to a particular village and ask the household for his or her or the family's ration card, they will have a ration card of different color, either yellow or orange, whether they are BPL or APL, sometimes with an Antyodaya stamp on it to indicate the poorest household even within the BPL category. Okay. Now, how is this classification arrived at? This is arrived at through what is called as a below poverty line census. Please note, this is a census. In the case of the National Sample Survey, it is a survey. Okay, that is a sample survey consisting of some 40,000 households in urban areas and 70,000 households in rural areas. Whereas the below poverty line census in rural areas is going to cover each and every household in the rural area. Okay. So whether the household is eligible for subsidized food grain from the public distribution system, whether it is eligible for subsidized credit, whether it is eligible to participate in many of the, you know, so-called flagship programs of the government, would all depend on whether they are classified as BPL or APL. Okay. So if you are talking of a really needy household and if it is wrongly classified as above poverty line, its very survival is going to get threatened. Okay. Think of the, if I know many of you are, you know, coming from rural areas or from different parts of the country, you have got a first-hand experience of the most deprived households living in the rural areas. Think of what would happen if they don't actually, if they're not classified in the below poverty line category, if they're actually given an APL card. Their very survival would be threatened because then they would no longer be eligible for subsidized food grain from the PDS or a range of other programs and schemes that are launched by the government. So unfortunately in India, you have this watertight categorization of BPL and APL. If you are BPL, you're eligible for a range of programs and schemes. If you're APL, you're eligible for virtually nothing. Now, how did this whole issue of BPL and APL really start? In the 1980s, there was a program by the name of Integrated Rural Development Program, IRDP. Many of you might have heard of it or even read about it. Now, in this particular program, at the end of the program, it was felt that it is the relatively better off households in the rural areas who have benefited. The poorer households tend to have been excluded. And then the whole focus came as to targeting the poor households. Why don't we have programs targeted only at the poor households? Now the moment you try to talk of targeting the poor households, the next natural question that is going to arise is then who are the poor households? How are you going to identify them? So in 1992, the first below poverty line census was carried out in India by the Ministry of Rural Development, and they used income per household as an indicator. So 11,000 per family per year was taken to be the cutoff level. Okay, 11,000 per family per year was taken to be the cutoff level. So any family having an income level below that would be counted as poor. Anyone having above that would be counted as non-poor. Now naturally you can imagine there are going to be a lot of methodological issues that are going to result. Firstly, please note, one talked of 11,000 per household. So the family size was nowhere taken into consideration. Whether the family consists of 2 people or of 10 people, that is nowhere taken into consideration. Secondly, there are a lot of problems with regard to use of income as an indicator. You know that in India, we are in rural areas, we are largely talking of majority of the population engaged in agriculture, okay, as their main occupation, whether it is by way of cultivators or whether by way of laborers. Now, these people, you know, don't necessarily engage in only one occupation throughout the year. If you ask me what is my income level, it is very easy for me to tell you, or it is very easy for you to find out also from other sources. But in the agricultural context, how does one find out? There is a large proportion of food grain that is actually only for self-consumption of the household, that is never sold in the market. What is what they call a subsistence agriculture. Okay. Then there might be wages that are paid partly by way of food grain, partly by way of cash. The male member in the household might be working as an attached laborer. The female might be working as a daily wage laborer. The children might be working in some kind of, you know, activities such as grazing of cattle. Once they become physically capable, they also start working as agricultural laborers. In the post-agricultural season, you might have people working for private contractors or now working in the employment guarantee scheme, the National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme. So it's very difficult to actually pin down one particular source of livelihood. Okay. There are a range of activities that these households engage in, largely for their survival. So even if one wanted to, it's very difficult to arrive at some accurate estimate of income on the basis of which one can call this household as poor or non-poor. Secondly, obviously, if you are going to ask the household its income and the household knows the purpose of the survey, then there is going to be an incentive to underreport. And there is absolutely no way to verify as to what is the actual income level. Thirdly, there is one more methodological issue that income levels tend to fluctuate, especially in the agricultural context. If you have a good crop this year, you might have your income level might go up. If you have a bad crop due to, you know, flood or drought or whatever, you might see your income levels sharply plummeting. Now, in spite of a, you know, increase in the level of income in a particular year, doesn't mean the household is going to spend all that income on buying. You know, it's not that the consumption of that household is going to go up to that extent. They might actually save a certain extent and consume the rest. Similarly, if the income level sharply falls in a particular year, it doesn't mean that a household is not going to consume anything altogether. They might actually draw on the previous year's savings. So that is why expenditure is, you know, considered to be a much more stable indicator than income. And the government of India, the National Sample Survey, only collects data on the expenditure, not on the income. Now, not surprisingly, if we here can think of various problems with income as an indicator, these were discussed at that time as well. In 1997, you had the second below poverty line census that was carried out. So this time they had a two-step criteria or a two-stage criteria, what they called. The first was what they called as the exclusion criteria. So there are 5 sets of questions that were asked to the household. For example, I'll just give you certain examples here. Let us say, do you have a pakka house or do you have a kacha house? Okay, if you have a pakka house, you will automatically be excluded from being considered as poor. Okay. Now it might happen that a pakka house has actually been constructed under a government scheme. Okay, or the pakka house may have been constructed by somebody's father or grandfather and the economic situation of that household has now declined. Then there was a question on land, ownership of land. Nowhere was the quality of land taken into account. Okay, in tribal areas, for example, you will see people having large plots of land, but it is virtually uncultivable or very bad quality. Whether it is irrigated, unirrigated, that is also nowhere asked. Now, if the household, you know, happens to pass all those exclusion criteria, if it does not have any of this, you know, if it does not have a pakka house, if it does not have land below a certain area and so on and so forth, second step is then the expenditure level of the household will be asked. And then the household will be classified into BPL or APL depending on the existing poverty line based on the expenditure level. Now, naturally, there was a lot of criticism in this as well. In 2002, this, if I might call it, this tragedy of errors is continued. And please note that this is not simply an academic issue that we are discussing. This is something on which the very survival of that rural household depends. Okay. In 2002, they now came up with 13 household characteristics and indicators against each of those characteristics. So each household would be scored from 0 to 5, depending on, for example, if you are houseless, you'll get a score of 0. If you have a pakka house with a certain kind of roof and so on, you'll get a score of 5, the maximum score. Now, this also generated a lot of controversy because some of the indicators are such that they absolutely made no sense. For example, one of the indicators used was availability of clothing. Okay, now availability of clothing means whose clothing are you going to ask? Is it the head of the household? Is it a respondent? How are you actually going to go inside the house and verify what kind of clothing is available to that household? How are you going to take into account the climatic variations? Naturally, in a colder climate, more clothing will be required. What about the quality of clothing? Okay, my shirt might be costing here 500 rupees. That laborer's shirt might be costing 10 rupees. Okay, there is a vast difference in the quality of clothing. So a lot of problems arose in this as well. This survey was actually implemented and the government programs were implemented on the basis of this categorization of BPL and APL. In 2007, the next BPL census was to be carried out. By this time, the government was actually quite confused because it wanted to persist with this approach of targeting. But what kind of criteria to actually use? There was no unanimity on that. So in 2009, finally, they appointed another expert committee, this time under the chairmanship of N.C. Saxena, who was a senior government servant. And it consisted of many eminent people, Harsh Mandar, Aruna Roy, many of the people whom we identify very closely with a lot of the programs that were initiated particularly by the last government. They were all members of that particular committee. And they came up this time with something what they called as automatic exclusion criteria and automatic inclusion criteria. So certain people would be automatically included and certain people would be automatically excluded. Let us say if you are a widow-headed household in a rural area, you will be automatically included. If you belong to a primitive tribal group, you will be automatically included. Automatically excluded, they had certain set of criteria which were not very different from that used in the previous BPL census. After that, in 2011, the government came up with the idea of conducting a socio-economic and caste census. So you might have heard about this in your first module, that for the first time since 1931, the government decided to conduct a caste census. And that was going to not only ask the household the individual caste it belongs to within the category, but it was also going to verify whether the household belonged to APL or BPL on the basis of a number of other questions that were going to be asked. And that socio-economic caste census has still not been completed in certain parts of the country. And now they're saying that by this year, end of this year, or maybe by next year, they're actually going to release that list. And that will then be used to classify these households into BPL or APL. Now, the reason I went through all this story is to tell you that we might use this term poverty very simply. Or, when you hear the budget speech of the government, of the finance minister, saying that so many crores, 1,000 crores rupees have been devoted for this poverty alleviation program or for the poor households. The first question that arises is on what basis are you actually categorizing a particular household as poor or non-poor? Okay. And this whole problem has taken place because of this approach of a poverty line. You're trying to differentiate the population into poor and non-poor. Now there are various other kinds of conceptual issues that one comes across in trying to define this term poverty. Firstly, is one talking of absolute poverty or is one talking of relative poverty? So if you go to that earlier definition, deprivation with respect to a normatively specified minimum living standard. When one is talking of a minimum living standard, one is necessarily talking of absolute poverty. Okay, that itself, might be changing over a period of time. So in a sense, your absolute poverty itself is relatively defined. 25 years from now, the minimum living standard that we consider today may not really hold. Relative poverty means compared to the rest of the population. The simplest method of doing that is, let us say, with respect to the average. Take the average expenditure level or average income level. Anybody falls below that average would be counted as poor. So this relative poverty has, tended to be used more in the developed countries, and developing countries have been working more with the notion of absolute poverty. Secondly, are you trying to understand poverty at the individual level or are you trying to understand poverty at the household level? generally the information that tends to be gathered is from the household. So expenditure of the household, they are not going to ask each member of the household as to what is your expenditure. But then there might be certain inequalities that are there within the household. You already had a session on gender issues, for example. Okay, there might be gender inequalities. There might be neglect of the elderly population within the household, neglect of the children. Okay, all these are examples of intra-household inequalities which may not be captured if you're trying to understand poverty at the household level. But then if you want to understand these issues within the household, you necessarily have to do some kind of a field study to try and capture that. The secondary, you know, sources of data at the macro level are not going to actually tell you much. Then how do you actually measure poverty? Okay, let us say we have a poverty line, some kind of a magic line that is differentiating the population into poor or non-poor. Now, how are you going to measure poverty? Okay, what is the meaning of measurement of poverty? On what basis are you going to say that a particular country or a particular state or a particular social group has got more poverty than other? The extent of poverty is more or less in one particular country as opposed to another. The simplest way would simply be to count up the number of people below the poverty line. So all the people who have an expenditure level below, say, that poverty line level, just count all of them up and that would give you the absolute number of the poor. So in the Indian case, the absolute number of the poor, even according to official estimates, is something like 400 million people. Okay, that is the absolute number of the poor in India. The problem that arises here is when you are trying to do some kind of a comparison. Let us say you are trying to compare India with Bangladesh. Is the extent of poverty higher in India or is it higher in Bangladesh? If you look at the absolute number of the poor, the answer would always be India, because simply by virtue of the larger population. But then one also has to consider as a proportion to the total population. So the total number of poor divided by the total population, that is referred to as the headcount ratio. And that is the most commonly used measure of poverty. So in the newspaper, when you read statements such as the incidence of poverty in India is 30% or 35%, etc., they're essentially working with a measure of poverty that is the headcount ratio. Now, you know, various people subsequently pointed out problems with the use of headcount ratio as a measure of poverty. One of the first persons to do that was actually Amartya Sen. The problem that arises here is you have a poverty line and your headcount ratio is telling you the proportion of the population living below the poverty line. But it does not tell you the distribution of the income or distribution of people below the poverty line. So in one scenario, it might be that everybody is living very close to the poverty line level. In another scenario, everybody is living very far from the poverty line level. So the depth of poverty is not really reflected in your headcount ratio. Secondly, when we talk about the poor, if you talk of 400 million people, they are also not going to be a homogeneous group in terms of the living standards. There is going to be a lot of inequality among the poor also. So how do you capture that? So to capture this, now people have started using what are called as poverty gap measures. Now it is totally beyond the scope of this particular lecture to go into these things in detail. But I just wanted to familiarize you that there are these three measures of poverty. One is looking at absolute number of the poor. One is the headcount ratio, that is as a proportion to the total population. And the third is the poverty gap measures that take into account the depth of poverty and also the inequality among the poor. Then how do we take into account the time dimension? Has that particular household been living in poverty for most of its life or even across generations? Let us say my father was an agricultural laborer. I am an agricultural laborer. Okay, there has been an intergenerational transmission of poverty. I've been living in poverty across generations. That is a case of chronic poverty. And most of the households we understand in India as poor are largely the chronic poor households. They've been living in poverty for most of the life or even across entire generations. Transient poor would be a case where it is a non-poor household, but it has slipped into poverty because of some shock to the household, some shock or some adverse event. It might be due to a drought or some such natural calamity, say drought, flood, earthquake, death of a primary, breadwinner of the family or some serious illness in the family. Because of this, that household has actually slipped into a situation of poverty. Now, it would be called as a transient poor household if it can actually come out of this. Others, you might very well find that it has slipped into a situation of chronic poverty. So even if you look at the interventions that are required, interventions required for chronic poor households are sometimes very different from the transient poor households. What is this third term we have used here? Vulnerability. Now in many of your programs, you must be having whole courses just devoted to this particular term, especially in School of Habitat Studies, Disaster Management, and so on. Now there are various kinds of meanings that are attributed to this term. In terms of a poverty line thinking, vulnerable households would be those who are the non-poor households but living very close to the poverty line, just above the poverty line. In that particular class interval, just above the poverty line. So, if one has to put it simply, living on the edge. Any adverse shock to the household and it will be pushed into a situation of poverty. That is in terms of the poverty line interpretation of vulnerability. But much of the discussion of vulnerability that you would have encountered in much of your programs would be in the context of risk. So those households who are more exposed to risk and also those who are more defenseless against risk, those would be categorized as vulnerable households. So in fact, there has been no consensus on the estimate of poverty in India, as you will discuss in your next module. The estimate of poverty in India has ranged from 25% to 80%. There is no consensus. But a few years back, there was a committee that was appointed by the government. Many of you might have heard of it, the National Commission for Enterprises in the Unorganized Sector, headed by Arjun Sengupta, an economist. And they came up with the estimate that 77% of the India's population can actually be categorized as poor and vulnerable. So 77% of India's population are living on an expenditure level of less than rupees 20 a day. And those were classified as poor and vulnerable. Then, of course, one can talk of the distinction between monetary poverty and multidimensional deprivation. Now, much of the discussion on poverty, particularly coming from economists, has largely focused on the expenditure or the income dimension. That is, that household does not have a required level of income to meet the basic needs. It will be classified as poor, or its expenditure level is below the minimum required to meet its basic needs. It will be classified as poor. But a much more broader understanding of poverty is by way of what one could call as multidimensional deprivation. Now here also one can give a number of examples. I don't know if whether Professor Parasuraman in his inaugural lecture here or if in any of your other courses, you must have heard about this M-Ward project that the institute is engaged in, transforming M-Ward East. So for those of you who don't know, very quickly, M-Ward came out to be the most deprived ward in the city of Mumbai, according to the Human Development Report of Mumbai. So that is when, 2-3 years back, the institute engaged in a field action project on transforming M-Ward. So around 3 years back, all of us, all the faculty of the institute, and all the students were engaged in a baseline survey in M-Ward, in the slum area. And that was to form the basis of a lot of information that was going to be translated into some kinds of programs. Okay. Now, when one went to these areas, these slum areas, the moment one entered those particular localities, immediately the air was filled with flies. When one went to the houses must have been something like 2 to 3 times the area I'm standing in. Okay. No sanitation facility, a big crisis of water. Okay, so these are all the aspects of the living conditions. If you look at the health indicators, education indicators, they are the worst among all the wards of Mumbai. Now, if you try to look at the income data, many of these are people who are working as small traders, small shopkeepers, hawkers. It might very well happen that their income level, expenditure level might be above the poverty line level. So are you going to call them as non-poor households? Using our understanding of monetary poverty, yes, they would be non-poor. But then if one understands it in the context of multidimensional deprivation, there is definitely some very important dimension of deprivation that we would be neglecting if we call them as non-poor. Okay, this is just to give you one example. Much of this problem really arises because as a professional, we tend to look at poverty from a certain perspective, and the poor themselves might tend to understand poverty from an entirely different perspective. So if one asks the poor as to what do they mean by poverty, they are not going to, you know, typically identify in terms of the income or expenditure level. They are going to identify in terms of their quality of life, their living conditions, okay, access to health care, many other things. Incidentally, you know, I was going to give the example later on, but there is this interesting book by a person called Ganesh Devi, G.N. Devi. The title of the book is A Nomad Called Thief, Reflections on Adivasi Silence. A Nomad Called Thief, Reflections on Adivasi Silence. And that book is there in the library, you can look it up. In that book, there is a chapter by the title Development. So this G.N. Devi is a very senior activist working in the tribal areas of Gujarat. And he says that, you know, we were constantly being bombarded with this term development or vikas or whatever we understand in the local language. So I decided to ask the local people, the Adivasi people, as to what do they mean by development or this term vikas. And the kind of answers that people have given, he has actually listed in that particular chapter. So he says, when I raised this question before the Adivasi people, they said, when our children have food to eat, okay, when we don't have to lead a life of dependency on others, when we have access to some basic health care, and he has said that their eyes actually became moist as they said these things, that to them would be development. So this would be one way of looking at poverty from the perspective of the people themselves. I can give you one more example here. A few years back, you know, you must have heard of human development reports. I'll be coming to that point later on. So there was this Maharashtra Human Development Report that was prepared in 2002, and according to which Nandurbar, Jalna, and Yavatmal, these came out to be the three most deprived districts in the state on the Human Development Index. Gadchiroli was of course also there, but Gadchiroli, they did not go in for any, you know, field research projects because of the Naxalite issue at that point of time. But these three districts were chosen for a field research study on what should be the action research strategies with respect to health and education to actually improve the human development indicators in these districts. So I was involved in a study in Nandurbar district. That is it's a tribal district located at the northern tip of Maharashtra. Now, during this study, there were the researchers who came into contact with tribal women, that is, you know, specifically trying to understand perceptions of tribal women. And one of the issues that came up was that tribal women said that at the time of pregnancy, we actually reduce our food intake. Okay. Now, this goes totally contrary to what one would expect. At the time of pregnancy, we would expect that they increase their food intake to deliver a healthy baby. But they said because there is no infrastructure that exists in the region with respect to health care, we try to deliver a low birth weight baby. And we can only do that by reducing our quantity of food. Now this, as a professional going to the area, there is no way by which I could have understand this particular aspect without talking to the people. So the point here is there are many qualitative aspects of poverty that tend to get totally, you know, neglected in this whole emphasis on measurement of poverty. And there is a whole, you know, huge literature and very important literature that has emerged on this. In fact, Professor Parasuraman, when he was director of ActionAid Asia, he also edited a book that is there in the library on listening to people living in poverty. Okay, listening to people living in poverty, which particularly deals with voices of the poor. Another person who has worked extensively on this is a person by the name of Robert Chambers. And this is an article which I've listed at the bottom of the slide, Poverty and Livelihoods, Whose Reality Counts. This is an excellent article. For those of you who are interested, you can actually look it up. It is downloadable from the website. So just by way of example, he has given a list of some criteria used by the local people as an indicator of their ill-being. Okay, they don't use the word poverty as an indicator of their ill-being. So being disabled or chronically sick, widows, you know, lacking in land or other forms of physical capital, not being able to bury their dead, you know, this is an international context he's talking of. With respect to food security, having more mouths to feed, lacking people who can actually fend for their families in the event of crisis, and so on and so forth. You can actually go through this list. Being dependent on common property resources. This is a very, you know, common coping mechanism that is followed by the people to deal with food shortages. So when one tries to understand poverty, one has to understand not only its quantifiable aspects, one also has to understand the qualitative aspects of poverty. And that is the main point which I'm trying to make here. Now there is so much of debate on, as I told you before, on who are the poor and who are the non-poor. Let us for a moment then try to, you know, pause and think as to whom would we classify or, you know, try to understand as the poorest individual in the country or in society. As an example, the poorest or the most deprived individual in society. It would probably be somebody like a disabled elderly woman who is a widow, belonging to one of the lowest castes and living in one of the most backward regions in the country. So there are these so many, you know, kind of layers of disadvantages that individual is facing. And such an individual would be most in need of social assistance for their survival. So the poorest people would be those who are dependent on the outside relief interventions for their survival. Okay. Now, if one tries to understand poverty in this larger context of deprivation, then one has come very close to understanding the notion of human development. And that is what I'm going to talk of now. Okay, again, this is a term which you have heard of, I'm sure, many times, especially in the context of the Human Development Index. You know, at least once a year, you have the headline in the newspaper that India ranks so and so on the Human Development Index, okay, somewhere towards the bottom. Now, to understand this term human development, one has to understand this development discourse in a global context and not only the context of India. Okay, so many of the international agencies have played a major role in the evolution of this development discourse. So, you know, just to give an example, sustainable livelihoods, that is a term often used by the DFID. Human development, term often used by the UNDP. Okay, World Bank will talk of a world free of poverty or something like this. Somebody else will talk of human security. Somebody else will talk of human rights. So there is a lot of, you know, if I might say, a lot of jargon out there. And one has to really then understand what one is talking of. Okay. Now, some of these things probably, I don't know, in the last module you may have discussed in some way, I don't know, when you talked of the development project in the post-colonial era and so on. I don't know to what extent it was discussed. But the development project, so-called, it really emerged as a post-Second World War phenomenon. Now, what happened in the aftermath of the Second World War? Firstly, you had many of the Western countries who were ravaged by war. And you had many countries, such as India, in fact, starting with India, who were under the impact of colonial rule and who were coming out of that. And who were then embarking on a path of planned economic development. Okay. So the focus here was on economic growth, on an increase in per capita income. You know, how are you going to increase your national income, whether in the aggregate or in per capita? How are you going to provide for the range of goods and services that are going to be required by the people? Okay, so in India, for those of you who are familiar with, there was a Mahalobnis model that laid emphasis on improving the productive capacity of the economy. There was a lot of emphasis on agricultural production that came on later on, so on and so forth. So focus was on economic growth, and the term development was largely understood in terms of economic growth. Now, this did not really lead to the desired reduction in poverty. Now, why is it? You know, it's common sense. If your increase in income is only accruing to certain sections of the population, it may really have no impact on poverty whatsoever. Just to give you a simple example, if there are 10 people in society, these bottom 9 people have an income level of, say, 1 rupee or 1,000, whatever unit you are considering, and this 10th fellow, the richest fellow, has an income level of 10 rupees. Okay, what is the total income? 9 plus 10, 19. Your per capita income is 19 by 10, 1.9. Let us say this is in 2014. Over a period of 5 years, at the end of this particular government's term, from this 1, we have gone up to, say, 1.5. Or for simplicity, let us say 1 has remained 1. And 10 has become 100. What is going to be the total income? It will become 109. And the per capita income will be 10.9. So whether in per capita terms or in aggregate terms, you are going to see that your economic growth has taken place at a considerably higher rate. Okay. But then, if your poverty line is defined as an income level of 2, still 90% of our population is living below the poverty line. So I've just given you one very simple example, but similar kind of analysis you can really extend to the macro level, okay, at the level of millions or lakhs or whatever. Now, naturally, if we can think of this kind of critique of an increase in national income not necessarily being an indicator of development, there are many people at that point of time who are also writing about these issues. One of the persons was by the name of Dudley Sears. Now, for those of you who are from the Development Studies program, Dudley Sears was, I think, one of the founding directors of the Institute of Development Studies at Sussex and one of the pioneers of the subject that is today called as Development Studies. So he has a very interesting article titled Meaning of Development. This was written in 1969. This is again something which you can look up on the website. It is freely downloadable and a very good article. I just want to read out this particular paragraph to you. It's a very powerful paragraph. The questions to ask about a country's development are therefore, what has been happening to poverty? What has been happening to unemployment? What has been happening to inequality? If all three of these have declined from high levels, then beyond doubt, this has been a period of development for the country concerned. If one or two of the central problems have been growing worse, especially if all three have, it would be strange to call the result development even if per capita income doubled. This applies, of course, to the future too. A plan which conveys no targets for reducing poverty, unemployment, and inequality can hardly be considered a development plan. Now, this was written way back in the 1960s. I think this is as much relevant even to the Indian context today. Okay. Now, from these kind of criticisms that emerged, the discourse shifted from looking at development in terms of economic growth to a notion of redistribution with growth. So in the early 1970s, in fact in 1973, the World Bank brought out a publication by the title Redistribution with Growth. And ironically, one of the authors of that report, was Indian. I don't know if you can guess who it was. It was Montek Singh Ahluwalia, our previous deputy chairman of the Planning Commission. So this is basically trying to say that economic growth by itself will not lead to poverty reduction. Economic growth needs to be accompanied by a decrease in inequality, and that would lead to a faster reduction in poverty. Now, many people even today argue that this whole notion of inclusive growth that is being used, in what way is inclusive growth actually different from redistribution of growth? Or the first five-year plan used the term economic growth with social justice. In what way are these three terms actually different? So many terms are often used which you'll encounter in the literature, and if one really probes into it, one finds that they have only been used for some particular purpose, maybe a political purpose for the time, and many of them actually carry similar meanings. Okay. Now, from redistribution growth, the discourse in late 1970s, early 1980s, shifted to what was called as a basic needs approach. So the basic needs approach tried to say that, okay, so far still, even if you talk of redistribution growth, we are still talking necessarily only of the income dimension. Why not bringing these non-income dimensions of development and directly focus on what should be the basic needs of people? So this was again propagated by the International Labour Organization and the World Bank. So Paul Stretton, Mehboobul Haq, people like this were very closely associated with the basic needs approach. So they talked of things such as provision of adequate food, shelter, clothing, essential services. This almost appears to be like some kind of a dream, okay, if it is fulfilled. Now, unfortunately, this basic needs approach did not really take off. One reason for this is, at a conceptual level, what is going to be the threshold level at which you are actually going to specify a particular, any of these dimensions as having met the basic need? Okay. Secondly, at an operational level, what happened in the period of the 1980s was, I think when Professor Parshuraman talks to you about the role of international organizations, that was supposed to come before this session, he'll go into this in much more detail, the role of the World Bank, the IMF, and so on. In the 1980s, you had many of the developing countries going through a lot of macroeconomic problems. So Latin American countries were facing a massive foreign debt crisis, and they had to actually borrow from the World Bank and IMF. In return, certain conditionalities were imposed. Those are called as structural, you know, the resulting policies were called as structural adjustment policies. You also had Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan being in power at that point of time in the UK and US, who were actually talking of downsizing government, laying an emphasis on economic growth. Okay, so many of the features that we closely associate today with neoliberalism, those were present in the early 1980s. So the focus really shifted back to economic growth as development and a focus on other macroeconomic indicators. So this was in the period of the early 1980s. In the late 1980s, you also witnessed the beginning of the fall of communism in Soviet Union and Eastern Europe and democratic movements in many parts of the world. So if I recollect correctly, even the students' protest that took place in China was around the period of 1980s. Okay. In this particular context, the human development concept really emerged, largely as a reaction to looking at development only in terms of economic growth or in terms of these macroeconomic indicators. There were a number of individuals and organizations who contributed to the emergence of the human development concept of human development, and more importantly, its survival over the last 20 to 25 years. So Amartya Sen in the 1980s, I expect all of you have heard of Amartya Sen, the winner of the Bank of Sweden Prize in memory of Alfred Nobel. So he and Mehbubul Haq, they were classmates at Trinity College, Cambridge. And in the late 1980s, Mehbubul Haq had joined the UNDP as special administrator. And it is at that time that Amartya Sen was also arguing for a broader notion of development. And the United Nations, possibly, you know, some people argue as a rivalry to the World Bank, initiated these human development reports, which would rank the countries not on the basis of the per capita income, but on the basis of their human development index. You know, if you look at the World Bank publications, even today, there is something called as a World Development Report, which ranks countries on the basis of per capita income. So low income country, lower middle income country, higher middle income country, and high income country. So countries are ranked, you know, classified as developed or developing on the basis of their per capita income. So the UNDP said that we will rank countries on the basis of their human development index. What that is, I'll come to very shortly. And that is how this whole talk of human development really started. So what do we then really mean by human development? To understand this, one can discuss the notion of development as discussed by Amartya Sen. You know, for those of you who may not be familiar, Professor Sen is he's a professor of philosophy and economics at Harvard University. In fact, there are economists who think that he's a philosopher, and philosophers who think that he's an economist. Okay. So there is a lot of philosophical underpinning to his writings. And that you'll also see in these three notions of development that we have discussed here. Development as expansion of capabilities, development as widening of choices, and development as freedom. So what does this really mean? Let us take the first one. Okay, development as expansion of capabilities. So Sen used two notions in his writings. One was the notion of capability, and one was the notion of functioning. Okay, functionings, he said, are the range of things that a human being had reason to value in his life. Let us say, to be educated, to be well nourished, to participate in the life of community. These are examples of what he called as functionings. The range of things that a human being has reason to value in his or her life. And then the issue is, does the individual have the capability to achieve those functionings? Okay. So let us say I'm an agricultural laborer. I want to educate my children. Do I have the capability to do so? Okay. If I'm an agricultural laborer, I want to educate my children. Do I have the capability to do so? Development then would be viewed as an expansion of capability. Okay. Another way of understanding this is development as widening of choices. It's basically putting the same in a different language. Am I being able to lead the kind of life that I would choose to? am I being able to lead the kind of life that I would choose to? That is development as widening of choices. And the third is development as freedom. Now, for those of you again who are familiar with the literature, there is actually a book by this title, Development as Freedom by Amartya Sen. What does this really mean? Again, it is very similar to those earlier two notions. So in his very recent book, Idea of Justice, he has given one very good example of development as freedom. Let us say one has to decide what to do on a Saturday evening. Okay. Or since some of you seem to be so restless, let us say what to do today evening. Okay. Are you going to stay at home or are you going to go outside? Okay. So there are these two choices that are available to that person, either to stay at home or to go outside. Let us say the person makes a choice of staying at home. So person has made a choice of staying at home. The outcome is that that person is now stayed at home. Okay. Compare that to a scenario where some people come to his house, tie him up to a chair and force him or her to stay at home. Okay. In both cases, the outcome is the same. It's a very extreme example. If one is not happy with tying up, let us say lock him up. Okay. In both cases, the outcome is the same, that an individual has stayed at home. But the process is different. So when we talk of development as freedom, we are also then focusing on the process aspect of development. Okay. Now, over the course of the last few years in the institute, we have carried out a large number of training programs, workshops on human development for government officials, both at state government level, at central government level, etc. Now, even if, you know, after you have completed your post-graduation and you're working for a development agency, and let us say the district collector asks you, so what have you learned about the meaning of development? What do you mean by development? And if you say, sir or madam, development means expansion of capability, widening of choices, development means freedom, possibly he may not even offer you a chair to sit down or may not even offer you a cup of tea. Okay. Obviously, one has to put this into simpler language. What does this really mean? Okay, it's all right for Amartya Sen to say that. But Amartya Sen is not going to come and work for that particular organization. To put it very simply, then human development means that development is about improving the quality of people's lives. Okay, human development is about, the human development concept says that development is nothing but improving the quality of people's lives. Second key aspect of human development is that development is about people, and people are the real wealth of a nation. So typically, if you open any human development report, it is going to start with the sentence, development is about people, and people are the real wealth of a nation. Thirdly, we were talking earlier of looking at development in terms of economic growth. Human development says that economic growth is a means to an end and not an end in itself. Economic growth by itself is not an end. It is a means to an end. The end we are talking of here is human well-being or quality of life. Now, you know, you might say that if this is all you wanted to say, human development is about improving the quality of people's lives, you might as well have finished it in the first 5 minutes and made our lives happier. The class would have been over in the first 5 minutes.